Hello, I'm Char Lyons. I'm the historian here at South Church in Andover, and welcome to Andover's oldest museum, the South Church Burial Yard. Today I'm leading you on a walk that is geared for children ages 9 through 13. We will be traveling the same path as the walk that I did for 5 to 8 year olds, but with more of the history and the people of Andover who shaped, and South Church who shaped Andover, who are on these headstones. You should have read the preface that gives lots of the stats and background, so I do not have to take up time with that, as this is likely to be 52 minutes to an hour. As a reminder, just remember we are in a sacred place, and to monitor your children and have your dog on a leash, and please pick up after yourself, and to be respectful to other visitors and to those who rest here in God's care. So I've never really done this before. Please forgive me, and let's get started. I'm standing in the parking lot of the church. There's the side door. Right in front of me are some plaques that are in the ground. These are for Civil War soldiers that either died in the field or were in POW camps and died there and never were properly buried. If they had come home, they would have been buried here at South Parish. The parish, as I think I described in my preface, was pretty much like your school district. It's where you lived, where you went to school, where you went to church, and where you were eventually buried. So if you lived in West Parish, you were buried in West Parish, South Parish, North Parish, etc. So I'm over, I've gotten your bearings over by the playground. This big block right here is for George and Hannah Abbott, though we're standing on the wrong side for light. It was dedicated to them 200 years after they came to Andover in 1643. I'm gonna focus over here. You see this red house over here? You go just beyond it. Actually, all of this was Abbott land. His son John was our first deacon, and he donated the land on which this is now the fourth meeting house. On the land on which it was built. The first two meeting houses were on the same spot. The third was over here by the playground. And the reason this is called School Street is for the school building that was over here that was also established at the same time. And the parsonage was over by the White House back behind here. So we're going to move along. We're standing in front of the major family plot for our first minister, Reverend Samuel Phillips. It's his grandson, Samuel Phillips Jr., that started Phillips Academy, and he also worked with General George Washington on solving the problems of lack of gunpowder over by Powder Mill Square, which is by the post office. Samuel Phillips helped build a mill, and three people were actually killed in the drying process. And so several years ago, 2006 exactly, we had this headstone erected for the three men that were buried there. And these are from the records of the second minister, Reverend Jonathan French. One thing you might notice, these are the sides here, this white part. This is marble. It's very soft. Well, let me put this, for rock, it's soft. The block on top is granite. That's this hard stuff. And these black stones are slate, just to clarify some of that. Again, this is where our first minister is. Actually, his spot probably isn't here. He's probably buried someplace further down the hill. But when these lots became available, it was around the 1840s or so. Deacon Mark Newman bought these, gave this land for to be used as a as burial grounds. This is a tomb, again not really right where Samuel Abbott is buried, but again Abbott's all along here. We're on Abbott land. Way down here, there's a row of abbots. There's actually about 450 that I've identified out here. Samuel Abbott, Esquire, was a patriot in Boston, that when the American Revolution was brewing, he decided to move back to his hometown of Andover. He actually helped with giving money to Washington for the Continental Army. And later, he was one of the major benefactors of the Andover, think of it, the seminary. There was a seminary here that was, during the 1880s, if you were in ministry at all, this was the place to be. Okay, and actually right behind these stones, just turn right back around, we're looking at Colonel George Abbott. So I want to point out some interesting things here. Look at the writing. This is for Esquire. It's an old-fashioned S. They did for December. Look at this, is a 1. 51 years of age. And A-E-T actually means in the year of or at the age of 51. Look down here, they made a mistake. Look how nice and ornate, but look at this. Reader, think on death. So we're gonna walk down here and take a look at some different kinds of artwork that sort of tell the story behind the changing attitudes. So we start getting into a little bit softer thoughts on other people. But look at this. This is mostly in the 1700s. We have the grinning light bulb. And this is actually the angel of death. It says, "Here lies ye body of Mrs. Sarah Ballard." We've got our artwork again, round shoulders, all these designs. And look over at this one. This one's leaning. Look at this grinning light bulb. But then we come down the same row. We start getting into some more design, a lot of different design here. And look at this. We now go from the angel of death to just an angel. And this is actually being more to recognize more of the person and not just that you're dying. On some of these, it's just, I call them he lived, he died. There's not much information on them. Death was a matter of fact. But then by about the 1800s, some of that changed and we started getting into, like I said, more thinking of the person. And another thing that starts popping up are Greek, is an ode to Greek democracy, the father of democracy, or the founding of democracy, and an ode to our new country. You see our columns, urns, weeping willows. Look at the detail on some of these. I said these are in the same rows. Now we're gonna go down to Sarah Peavy. Look how different this is. This has actually been carved by a man named Joseph Marble. The sexton, who was the man who was taking care of the cemetery, would sell off broken headstones, or when the headstones, the original headstones were removed, and then people put up these great big headstones up here, these big monuments, he would sell off the parts for profit. And that was very much considered sort of a seedy thing to be doing, and I'll talk about that in a moment. But this little girl, actually there's two girls on this, we found this in the woods just back here when we started clearing everything out. It was just thrown up against the wall. Had no idea where she went. So again, I pulled these people together and put them here. And this is the headstone we just replaced last year. Found that she was a former slave. She was in the Negro section of the Andover Vital Records, and that at one point she did have a headstone. And this was all we knew about her. And again, since we knew she had a headstone, but it no longer was here, we put it here in this little area I call the Lost and Found. All right, get your bearings. I'm heading down the hill. Oh, before I forget, I'm aimed right down. See this tree right there? Right in there is a row of headstones for Pomp Lovejoy and Rose Coburn. Rose was the last person born into slavery in Andover, and there's a whole story behind that. I'm hoping to get that up on our website. I would suggest to your family to take a walkabout just even around the perimeter here, to just see how big this cemetery really is, and the different things you'll notice on the way. So I'm standing, I'm gonna make you sick doing this, where you see all the black headstones. I turn around and we come back through here. This was probably the original layout. Excuse me, I sneeze. Excuse me. Of the graveyard. And this land was all donated by Joseph Ballard, who originally came to the land around 1650. When we went to look for titles for where all the different properties for the church came from, absolutely nothing is found. All that was found was it was given by Barnards, who acquired the land in 1650. You see where the mills are over there? On this side of the river, all the way down to Ballard Vale, the Ballards owned all that land. And I'll get to another talking point about the Ballards. Now, I want to walk up here a little bit. You might find, why are these metal posts in here? Sometimes families would, literally, they would be buying their family plots, and they chained them off. I don't know, it was just part of what people did. Look how large this headstone is, how much was written on these. Another problem we had in finding out who all was buried out here is we have Hannah, Sarah, I think the next one is Hannah, and then Sarah, David, and Sarah. So it's, yeah, thanks. Thanks for helping me figure that out. One of the naming practices was that, let's say David and Sarah are married. Their first child is named after, if it's a girl, it's Sarah, it's a boy, David. So you go on, you have more children. Well, guess what? One of the older children dies, so David Jr. dies. The next child that's born, next boy, is named David. So you have these conflicts of names, and then you see how eroded things are to try to figure out which David is which Sarah is which. But we did that, we figured it out. We're in a little section here where I can tell these were erected many years after the dates that are written on them, for two reasons. Remember how I said that the wording and the epitaphs were kind of cranky, and the winged angel, well, this has more of an angel. It says a date of 1769. This is a little boy that was killed by a cart. And not only that, but the epitaph is actually very concerning and sad. And here is one that we replaced. This is more typical of the 1761 era, as you can see how fractured and broken it is. It's called a round-shouldered headstone. And this is much more consistent with what not only is written on it, but how the age of the stones, etc. And these have more of kinder words, and the later head of, you know, more of a person. Now, if you look really closely here, you can see a skull, a head, and our only headstone out here with little crossbones. This is for four girls that died. And if you look very closely, you can see four little sunrises peeping over the edge there. Another, I'm gonna just pop over here. This is an area that I like to talk about. Captain Charles Furbush was one of the four captains that responded for the militia to the call for Lexington and Concord. And he was also wounded at the Battle of Bunker Hill. And word came back that he had been killed in battle, and our second minister, Reverend French, was also a physician. And it was said that he dropped his Sabbath duties and rode into the teeth of battle to minister to the men, both spiritually and physically. And word was that Captain Furbush had died, but it turned out that he had been wounded, and his family dressed him up, and he walked right back into battle. Pop over here so we can see some other old, very old headstones. How different these are. These are Chandler's. It says here he was a second generation in Andover. Now, we know because of the style on these headstones, from this very rudimentary face and the symbols and the swirls and all, that this was a carver from Bradford. And remember how I had mentioned that we had headstones that were carved by a man named Joseph Marble. We actually have a couple of headstones here that were carved by somebody named A. Stone, a stone carver. Look how ornate this is. We're talking about a difference of 170 years here. I'm gonna come down and take a look at Sally and Jane. You guys might remember. Nope, I don't see it. He had to replace these guys. They were broken and laying on the ground. And Lock Street, just up the street, is named for Captain Lock. We're gonna walk back here and take a look at some more carvings by Joseph Marble. You may want to say, where am I? Well, here's the church for reference. Big tree right here. This is another one by Joseph Marble. Again, look at the parted hair, and then the distinctive nose and the eyes, the angel. And again, here's for two little boys, and they, this actually looks a whole lot like a child's face. This headstone carver is a fellow that is from Bradford, and this was pretty much his style. And all of these little dials and things, the symbolism, you know, it was part of the artistry of going on. This is very early folk art for America and Americana. And that we're right next to Dorothy Simpson, who has the grinning light bulb. Remember when I said I'll get to the Ballards later about them giving the land here? The second wave of the witch trials affected Andover more than any other town. More than 50 people were thrown in jail from Andover. And what started it was this woman's mother was very sick, and Joseph's brother had been to Salem. He was the, I can't think of the name of the guy, the sheriff basically of town. And he had been there, and he said, hey, how about asking some of those girls from Salem to see if they can figure out what's wrong with Elizabeth? Sure enough, they come to visit, and they deem that she, yes, has been bewitched. And wouldn't you know it, and two people were thrown in jail. And then wouldn't you know it, 5 days later, Elizabeth dies. So now word is rampant that witches are loose in Andover, and thus starts the second wave of people being just thrown in jail for very petty and merciless reasons. That's a whole nother story. I give a talk on that called Witch Andover, Witch Andover. But we come down the line, and we've got Abbott and Abbott and Abbott, another Abbott, and we have a Abbott and a Hall, and some of the naming practices, you get to going, well, why is everybody here with different names? With we've got more Ballards. Down at the mills, we were a very Scottish influence of immigrants that came here. And people would, you know, come to these enclaves, and they'd work a while and then move west to the next enclave. And this being a Scottish one, and Abbott Village being right down the hill here, when those people died, many of them had no place to bury their dead. So they would often come to the members of South Church, and people at South Church would say, well, we have room in our plot. You can plant, you know, you can bury your child here, or your wife, or whoever died. And was a very caring part of the ministry here of South Church. So you will see, you know, Abbott, Abbott Hall, Abbott, Abbott, Ballard, Ballard, Simpson. You will catch these different names in one area for that very reason. Another thing is that it often, if you had servants in your home, they would also be buried with your family. Now let me get my bearings. I'm gonna walk down here. Be careful, little rocks, little acorns. Oh, and if you see sticks, you wanna pick up sticks, go right ahead, put them at the base of any tree, or carry them up front by the dumpster up there. This rock was brought here in 1913. Remember I mentioned about the headstones being pulled out and sold for building materials? A woman named Charlotte Abbott, she was kind of the historian for the town, she started recognizing this as a terrible practice and that the new sexton had stopped that practice. But one of the things she wanted to acknowledge is that the original burial places for what she called to guard the pioneer dead of the South Parish was to represent that we no longer know where a lot of these people were originally buried. And so this is just to recognize that. And we've also used this then to put our SAR, our GAR. Here's one from, oh, Cuba. Our U.S. This is sort of our memorial rock. This was brought here from the Carmel Woods. It's in two pieces, and that is to represent the split between when Andover used to be one whole town, and in 1709, the population had moved enough south that a second parish was created. Thus, we had North Parish and South Parish. And this went on until 1855, when North Andover figured it, with most of the population now being in South Andover, or excuse me, South Parish, and then later West Parish, they figured they couldn't get anything voted. They needed a new high school, so they decided to withdraw, secede, if you will. They became known as North Andover, and part of the payoff of Andover, really South, which would have been South Andover, was that we got to keep the name Andover, and we paid North Andover $500, and they got to keep the fire truck. I'm going to turn around, and in here again you see a lot of gray. This is an area that's populated by mostly American Revolution people. You might notice over the hill here that we're looking down on the houses for they're being built by Habitat on Lupine Road. Bet you guys didn't know this cemetery was this big. We sit on about 5 acres. Now why is this roped off? Well, could have done a better job, but the wind knocked things down. These are two of our oldest headstones. Again, you can see the rudimentary face. What I love about this, these are actually bent. And part of the rope around this is just asking people, do not touch these headstones. So these slate ones, if they fracture, they will just break apart. But what's interesting with her, it says she died in the 64th year of her life. And over here, the only pair that we have left, these are called footstones. And if you look closely right down here, you can actually see the outline of a coffin. Did you know that the difference between a coffin and a casket is that a casket is in the shape of a rectangle and a coffin has 6 sides? You often see the, yeah, even on this with the raised, you know, place for arms and a head. So that's the difference. But head, obviously headstone, footstone, the direction in which they were laying. All right, I'm going to turn around and walk back up this way towards Saunders, and I'm going to take a little bit of a right-hand turn. Our second and third oldest headstones are for two little boys named Fosters. I think they died 8 days apart in 1729. Again, the very rudimentary carvings. Here's one that we were able to replace, even though much of the words were missing. I found it in a magazine, believe it or not, that was published in 1889, that actually spoke of how that this headstone was actually broken and in this shape at that time. So again, we've got some more grinning light bulbs right in there with our angel. You may remember a story last year about how we erected this headstone for Lucy Foster. She was a slave that was brought from Boston to Andover when she was the age of 4. She acquired her freedom here and lived with her mistress, who was Sarah Foster. And the reason we decided to put Lucy here is that right back in this row, we've got Fosters all over the place. We just saw several here. We've got Ames, we've got Chandlers. They were all intermarried to one another. And it just feels like this is exactly where Lucy would be in this very area. The patterns that were engraved came from patterns from some of her pottery that she had. And this is a flower that was on one of them. And in a bit of whimsy in the back, we have a lovely little teacup that she was known to entertain. So we're over here to Captain Benjamin Ames. He was another of the four that worked through the Revolutionary War. And Mr. Benjamin Ames down here, who was his son, he and four other men during the Battle of Bunker Hill were given the job of moving the books from Harvard Library. They basically felt that all of Charleston and Cambridge was just going to end up being burned because the British were really quite tired of these peasants rising up, and they were just going to burn till they would stop fighting. Didn't quite happen that way, but these men gathered the books in their carts and they brought them up here to Andover. And one of the homes that they went into, oh, I'll get to that in a moment. This is Adjuba Chandler. Fix this. He is our oldest known, with a headstone, militia, person in the militia at the time. Sorry, that was me taking a drink of water. So we come down here to Abbott's, and the Abbott House is just about three doors down to our right, and that's where the books were stored. Deacon Isaac Abbott was, well, it's kind of funny. I can't remember if it's this Isaac or that Isaac. They were both deacons. And that's another problem here. They're both married. Isaac married Phoebe. Isaac married Phoebe. Great, thanks. He ran the Abbott Tavern, which is up on Elm Street, and it's where George Washington came to visit and had breakfast there when Washington came to visit in 1789, I believe. But you want to talk about words being etched in stone? There's great debate on should Abbott be spelled with one T or two T's. We have two T's here, and we have one T over here. Can't make this stuff up. And again, we've got these rudimentary faces and another headstone here of Joseph Marble. Almost this very similar face. I walked past one before that's down the hill. I'll show you right over here. A couple of trees right in there is a row of that have very rudimentary, that again, the almost perfect faces of a child and a father. All right, now we're gonna move along. This was one of the sections in, we're here right now, that was purchased after, in the 1800s, and as you can see, most headstones here are marble. And when we were mapping out the cemetery, we were trying to figure out just who was on every headstone by doing quite a bit of work. Here's a row of Abbott's. This one on the end, there's actually three people on that. We figured them all out. Oop, I'm gonna walk back down the hill a wee bit. Pike School, there's the children of the Pikes. Over there, you might, an odd looking obelisk for the Means family, and right beyond it is a crypt. You can go wander around that side. That has been locked up, and over, I'm gonna walk to the end of this path here down towards the houses. And again, you'll get to see a bit more of the cemetery. I sometimes give a tour called Where No Man Has Gone Before. It's People don't realize this is all down here. You hear the... This, I'm not sure if I'm able to point it out. I think right there is a crypt for the Newman family. As I said, Deacon Newman had purchased all this land and donated it to the church. You can go way down there. Again, I really suggest doing a couple of walkabouts out here. Picking up sticks and just taking a good look. I can also do almost a tour on almost any topic out. If you want to learn more about the Andover Theological Seminary, more about Phillips Academy. I actually give a talk called The Industry of Education in Andover. Okay, we're going to be walking up back up here. A problem we're facing with our marble headstones is this kind of fracturing. These are built pretty much like they're a wedding cake series. If you see these, please don't try this at home, but they wobble because there's metal rods put in through there to help stabilize. Well, after, you know, 100, 200 years, with the expanding of those metal rods in winter and summer, it tended to fracture quite a bit of these. And so we have had to work very hard at, if we can't fix them, can we at least keep them from toppling over? It's one of the things we're often afraid of. Ah, speaking of headstone toppled over. You look over here, there's a tree that looks like it's down a little bit. Right over here's a headstone. That one we're gonna be lucky. We're gonna be, I think it got knocked down by, a limb hitting it. We're gonna be pretty lucky, probably just set it up and put it right back on the pins and glue it down. Or cut the pins off, and even better. Alrighty, I'm gonna head back up to the top. You guys can probably, these are the Phillips family that started the Phillips School up in New Hampshire. Why can't I think of that one? Exeter. And they were brothers of, they were sons of Reverend Samuel. You guys go hiking around here. Here's the Goldsmith family. And Clarence Goldsmith, the house that's right there at the front of the entrance of the Goldsmith reservation, he's buried here. He fought in World War I. And Bessie Goldsmith was quite a pioneer. She was the first female police officer in Andover. And she was quite an outspoken person for her time. She loved the woods. She was quite extraordinary in her, just her flair of storytelling, and is a member of the society, of our society. You know where Hidden Road is? It's named for David Hidden. And you might think, oh, here I thought it was just there because it sort of pulls off the side of the road, you really don't see it. Nope, David Hidden was the architect and builder of most of Phillips Academy. Well, actually, Phillips Academy and the seminary. And there's actually a drive on what's Phillips now, which had been part of the seminary, called Hidden Field. But that is in honor of him. If you can tell, we got a Holt mixed in with a bunch of Abbots. Lucy A. Pollock was a nurse during World War I, I believe. Come over here, we see the Swifts. This actually says Dr. Nathaniel Swift. He and his wife, he was a doctor in town. He ran a pharmacy and general store and general goods store, really. And the post office, which is where the TD Bank is now. Back towards the front. And this row is dedicated to the Fosters. More Fosters. There's actually three lines of Fosters in Andover. Two are intermarried and this one is not. But this Foster family still belongs to South Church. It says William Foster. He, Master Willie, ran a primary school for young boys to get into Phillips. and his house is down Salem Street. And excuse me, not Salem, Central Street. It's a great big house, it's still there. The boys would etch their names into the glass and into the woodwork, and it is still there today. Cheryl Foster of our congregation is living there now. And if we move just down toward this abbot, this has, let me think, 16 people on this headstone, goes on four sides, and nine of them are John. But the very first one there, even though we know that this is not the exact place where Deacon John was buried, this is here in honor of his family and in his name, Deacon John Abbott. And this whole row of abbots along here represent about 11 generations of abbots in the United States. They fought in every conceivable war, militia gathering. Some of our latest, we just buried David Maxwell here last year. And here's for a man that died in Okinawa. His body was never found. His name is John Radford, and he's here with his parents. And I often use this row when I'm out for giving tours like on Memorial Day and speak to the fact that the family, these families go back generations, and this is their family burial ground. And still is. Would you like to know who the Wilder and French families were? Oh, one thing interesting about this you might like. It's off a little bit. It's not square. And this is what happens when, again, you're off gravity a little bit and you get water in here. So when we finally figured this out years ago, we were able to get in here and seal off this crack. It looks like we could probably come out and give it another seal. But it did stop moving once we were able to do that. Again, these are all assembled, like the pieces are all of a wedding cake. And this was probably erected around late 1800s with immigrants polishing the granite. Back after having the railroads up, you brought the railroad, the stone from Vermont, and immigrants polished the granite to what it is today. All right, so I'm standing right next to the church. I'm going to walk back from where we came, and we're going to wrap this up in just a moment. We're going to go by the Kidder family. Francis Kidder was part of what was called Printer's Row. Deacon Mark Abbott had a house which is now on Phillips Academy, and he started the Andover Bookstore when realizing that the seminary and the academy did not have enough books. And he started a printing press here where the first Hebrew and Greek translations of the Bible in America were made. But Printer's Row also consisted of Flagg and Gould and Kidder. And they're all actually four houses in a row. They're white houses, actually right at the entrance of Hidden Road down off Main Street. So we're gonna walk over. One of my favorite headstones out here is for Reverend Loesch. Dr. Russell, actually his name was, Dr. Russell. He was a minister, a congregational minister that was drafted into the Second World War. He spent 4 years in Germany and England and as a ministering to the men. And he created the very first, the mentoring program, chaplaincy program. He was asked by the Congregational Church and the U.S. Army. He often was the first person, last person a pilot would see, and often the first when they'd come in or come in hot, and be the one that wrote to families and corresponded. And apparently how he also made a little altar for communion to take into the field for the men, just so they had a little bit of comfort of making an altar, making a communion table to make it seem a little more like church. And he would often go to 8 different places on a Sunday and give for church services. This is one of my favorite. One of the things I love about it is how when you get the sun behind it in the late afternoon, it just glows. And that was because his wife, Polly, loved quartz. Just walk down this road real quick. One more story about a Holt. We have a line of Holts along here too. This leaning headstone was another stone we found up by Dearborn Place up off Elm. And we figured it belonged with this headstone. Samuel Abbott, I believe I have the right one. No, I'm wrong. Here we are, I'm in the wrong place. Lewis G. Holt was shot through his stomach in the Civil War, came home and lived for another 2 years and then essentially succumbed to his wounds. But so that's some of the history we have of the people who have fought and lived and shaped Andover as we know it. So I'll give you one last pass here. I'm gonna flip it around, show you who I am, and say farewell. Thank you for being my guest today. Again, feel free to email me about any questions, and I'd love to talk to you some more. We have a fascinating history, and we only scratched the surface today. Have a good day. Bye-bye.